Today we are going to talk about one-dimensional convolution for regression problems. In a previous tutorial, we focus on one-dimensional convolution and discuss how it works in a simple example. As I received several questions about how to apply one-dimensional convolution onto a regression problem, I developed this notebook. If you need to refresh your information about one-dimensional convolution, please watch the previous tutorial on my YouTube channel. Today, we will use Keras Convolution 1D layer for a regression problem. As you might know, Boston House Prices dataset is a well-known dataset. We will first train a multi-layer perceptron model to predict house prices. Then, we will develop a model using Keras Convolution 1D layer. To train and test Convolution 1D model, we will reshape the train and test data such that Convolution 1D can work on them. If you are interested in deep neural networks and want to learn them by coding, please subscribe to my YouTube channel or follow my blog on Medium. Do not forget to turn on notifications so that you will be notified when new content is uploaded. You can access this Colab notebook by using the link given in the video descriptions. If you are ready, let's get started. Here you see the auxiliary functions. As a base model, I am going to use TensorFlow official example, which is implemented by a multi-layer perceptron model to compare its performance with my Convolution 1D model. Thus, we will be able to observe the relative success of Convolution 1D model with respect to a professional sample model. You can access the original notebook Predict House Prices Regression with Multi-Layer Perceptron here. If you run this notebook, you would generate mean absolute errors values different than the reported ones here due to the stochastic nature of neural networks. In a regression problem, we aim to predict the output of a continuous value like price or probability. Contrast with the classification problem where we aim to predict a discrete label. For example, where a picture contains an apple or an orange. This notebook builds two different models to predict the median price of the homes in Boston suburb during the mid-1970s. To do this, I will provide the models with some data points, so I will train the models, and then I will try to predict the prices. So let's see how can we upload dataset. Actually, the dataset is directly served by the TensorFlow. We can just download from the TF Keras datasets and then we load the data as train and test datasets. So when we check that there are 506 total examples and they are already split into training and test examples as seen on the screen. For each house, we have 13 different features. So the features are here. And according to these features, we are gonna predict the price of the house. These features have different scales and they have different meanings in numbers. But for the sake of the simplicity, I will not go over the details. But I would like to show you that here they have different scales. Someone changes between 0 and 1, someone changes between 0 and 5,000 or something. So let me show some data. So each row is a house and each column is a property feature of that house. And you see the different scale of the values in the attributes. So the labels are the prices of the houses in thousands of dollars. So when you see, for example, 21.1, it means that $21,100 the price of the house. As I already mentioned that the features have different scales. So the first thing that we need to scale these numbers by using normalization. After finding mean and the standard, we can scale or normalize the values of the train data and the test data. So we are normalizing the features. We are not normalizing the label, the price. So this is the multi-label perceptron model provided by the TensorFlow team. As you see that it is actually a simple sequential model, two hidden layers and one regression layer. So as an optimizer, they use RMS probe for the loss. Mean square error is used. And as a metric, mean absolute error is selected. After build, we can see the summary. So there are around 5,000 parameters. And as I said, two hidden layers here. Train this model quickly. Here we see that validation mean absolute error around $2,600. So let me show you the plot of the train and validation mean absolute errors, and these numbers are in $1,000 scale. So these are the epochs. So you see that we have the plateau, but the validation cannot get better than after the maybe the 100 epochs. So let's note that in validation set, the average error is about $2,600. You can ask that if it is a good prediction or not. Some ASUS are $15,000. So $2,600 error actually is not insignificant. So actually the prediction success is not so high. Let's try this model on the test data, and we see that the absolute error, mean absolute error, is around $2,900. So let me show you how the predicts works in test data. You see that it is a balanced result here and here, and there is no bias for greater or lower prices. So as an observation, we could say that MLP model handled the Boston ASUS prices regression problem. We already implemented. Actually, this implementation come from the Keras team. And now we can summarize that the validation error about 2,600 and testing error is about 2,900. Now let's create the convolution 1D model. Here we are gonna use sequential model with three convolution 1D layers and one max pooling 1D layer, and of course the output regression layer. The model build steps are wrapped in function build model as we did above. But before getting into the details of the model, we need to reshape the data. Why? Because you might remember that in our previous tutorial, convolution 1D layer expects and accepts input shape in three dimension, as the first dimension is the batch size, the second dimension is the time steps, and the third dimension is the input dimension. However, remember that our current data in the shape of two dimensions, batch size, number of samples, and the features. Remember, our features are 13. If you check here that you see that our train data shape is sample number and 13. And if you check the first sample, you see that the first sample has 13 features, as we know. And as we normalize all the values, here are the 13 normalized values. The question is that how can we convert these 13 features? Because the problem is that in that data set, we don't have any time steps. So we can create these time steps actually by using these features. So we are going to use each feature as a time step, and we are going to convert these two dimensional input to a three dimensional input by using the reshape function. So sample size will be the same. So we are going to use the train data shape the first dimension, which is the number of the samples in the train set. Then as a time step, I am going to use the number of the features in the training set, and the input dimension, I know that each feature has only one feature dimension, so I am going to use the one here. After that, we can reshape by using these three numbers. Now I will show the output. After the reshape, train data set shape becomes the number of samples, the number of time steps, and input dimension. So let's check the first sample shape. So there are 13 steps. Each of them is represented by one number. So look at the example here. Notice that we have one number for each features as the time steps. So after conversion, now we have a train data set whose shape is that batch size, time steps, input dimensions, which are 404, 13 and 1. Now we need to also convert the test data set into the same. But before continue, I would like to mention about how these batch size, time steps, input dimension will work with convolution 1D. Let me show you an animation that I prepared for you. Remember, convolution 1D layer have some attributes or parameters. I selected here filter 1, the kernel size 7, activation ratio. And if you do not provide stride and the padding, their default values are 1 and valid. Here you see that the filter moves one row or one time step at a time in one dimension. Okay? So because stride is 1, and when it arrives at the last row, it stops because the padding is valid. The filter applies the convolutional calculation on these rows and produce a single output because our filter is 1 for the moment. So that is a very very quick reminder of convolution 1D works. So if you want to see the details, learn the details, please check my previous tutorial about convolution 1D. The link is in the video descriptions. Okay. So after reshaping the test data as well, we can now create the ARM convolution 1D model. N time steps and number of features is already decided. Here is the sequential model. So we create with the input layer. Then we have the convolution 1D. Here we are going to use 64 different filters. And the kernel size will be 7, so each time 7 steps will be covered. And in between we have the dropout. The next layer also is a convolution 1D, this time 32 filters, and the kernel size will be 3. So each time step we are gonna cover 3 rows at a time. And then we have another convolution 1D with 16 filters. This time we are going to use kernel size 2. After these operations, we have the max pooling 1D to summarize the data with the pool size 2. Then we are going to flatten the results and supply the results to a dense layer. And after this dense layer, we have the output layer. So here is the number of features. We know that number of features is 1. We are going to use the optimizer as RSM probe, and we are going to use the loss mean square error and metric mean absolute error. After building and we can get the summary. So the R total parameter is 8000 or 9000 about. Here you notice that when we apply the convolution 1D here, since the we have 13 time steps or 13 rows, let's say. Each time we handle the 7 of them. So there will be total 7 steps over these 13 rows, applying 7 kernel size steps as in the animation. So there are 13 numbers or time steps. Each step we are applying the filter size 7, so covering 7 rows and moving strides 1, so moving 1 row at a time. Output will be 7. So you can check here that the output is 7. So if you apply the kernel size 3 to output 7 with a convolution 1D, so there will be, as you see here, 5 results, and the number of the results depends on the how many filters you use. So if you continue like that, you can calculate these numbers and the parameters. Let's train the model using the validation split again. Here you notice that this time the validation mean absolute error about $2,400. And let's plot the history. Here you see that now the validation after 2000 epochs not improve so much. But let me note that the average error in validation set is about 2400. So is it good or bad? As I already mentioned, it's not an insignificant amount error compared to the house prices. Let's apply this model to with the test data. And you see that the result of the testing mean absolute error is about $2,700. If you check the distribution of the predictions, you see that we don't have any bias. So it's a balanced prediction. It's good. Let's talk about the observations. So far we implemented the multi-layer perceptron model and convolution 1D model to handle the regression problem. You can check the MLP mean absolute errors in validation and in testing set, and you can compare the convolution 1D results here and here. You see that convolution 1D model is a competitive approach considering multi-layer perceptron model in a regression problem, actually in the specific problem. The important point is that to use a convolutional one-dimensional model, you need to reshape the input as batch size, time steps, input dimension. Here we create the time steps by using the features of the houses, and the input dimension is actually one number, so it's easy. So it is up to you how to convert your input in your problem to a three-dimensional input. You need to understand the concepts and you need to apply these concepts into your problem. I hope this tutorial helps you to use convolutional 1D layer successfully. If you like that tutorial, please click the like button and do not forget to get subscribed. Thank you for watching. See you in another video.